Hey guys, today I'm going to be reviewing the Quebec Bridge collapse in 1907. I got my notes here and I'm ready to go. This is for my project for my engineering strength and materials class. The Quebec Bridge was 20 years in the making, from the founding of the Quebec Bridge Company in 1887 to the bridge's collapse in 1907. A cantilever bridge was proposed as the most feasible option to bridge the harsh, icy waters of the St. Lawrence River. The bridge collapsed during a construction on August 29th, 1907, killing 75 workers. Only 11 of the workers on the span recovered alive. Some bodies were never found. A second attempt was made to bridge the St. Lawrence River. However, it also suffered a partial collapse when the middle span fell into the river. 13 workers were lost in this incident. The bridge was finally completed in 1917. It still stands today. So what events occurred that led up to the collapses of this economically important bridge? Let's find out. The St. Lawrence River was the main channel for trade for Quebec during the summer. During the winter, it filled with ice and trade was completely cut off until the summer would return. The need to bridge the St. Lawrence River was fueled by Quebec's need to be competitive in trade. Montreal already had a functional railway system, which passes through from the west to the east, connecting it to Toronto. Quebec was left even further behind when Montreal began construction in 1854 on the Victoria Bridge, which was completed in 1859, connecting it to Canada's western ports. This development quickly established Montreal as Canada's leading eastern port and had severely overshadowed Quebec as a serious contender and or contributor in trade. Although the demand for the bridge over the St. Lawrence River was at an all-time high, the job would prove to be no easy task. As the bridge was erected, workers and supervisors found noticeable midpoint deflections in some point of the cords. When the workers tried to rivet the joints between these two cords, the pre-drilled holes did not line up. In addition, bends, or deflections, were observed in some of the most heavily loaded compressed members. Over time, some of the member deflections increased. The panels are numbered from 1 through 10. The anchor arm panels have an added A notation. So for example, the A9L notation refers to the cord located on the anchor arm, within the ninth panel, and on the left or west side of the bridge. Some of the major cords with their corresponding deflections with these dates and measurements are presented on this table. Deflections were first noticed as early as mid-June, and they were reported to Cooper by his on-site inspector, Norman McClure. Cooper was the man in charge of this project. Norman McClure was the head inspector for this project. Compression members had been cambered so that under load, the joints would line up and could be riveted together. However, some joints failed to close. Both Cooper and Norman presumed that the relatively small deflections had occurred due to some unknown pre-existing condition. They were not alarmed. Subsequent inspections turned up more deflecting cords in August. Again, these were reported to Cooper on the same day that they were discovered. Cooper wired a message back referring to the cords 7L and 8L, asking, how did bends occur in both of these cords? The chief engineer of the Phoenix Bridge Company, the company contracted to build this bridge, replied saying that they simply did not know. The chief design engineer for the Phoenix Company was certain that the bend was put in the cord ribs at the shop where it was prefabricated. He later admitted that he never actually saw the cords in question. However, Norman McClure wrote, one thing I am reasonably sure of, and that is that the bend has occurred since the cord has been under stress and was not present when the cords were placed. While this dispute of how the bend occurred in the cords 7L and 8L were still ongoing, McClure reported to Cooper another similar bend in cords 8L and 9L. The members with these deflections were the lower cords of this truss on either side of the pier members with the highest compressive loads under the negative moment across a pier. A disturbing pattern was emerging. The members under the highest compressive loads were gradually buckling. Eventually, after disputes with the inspectors and Phoenix Bridge Company were had, the progress had been made in the discovery of why the members were buckling. The buckling ultimately led to the bridge's collapse into the St. Lawrence River, killing 65 workers. Only 16 of the 65 bodies were recovered. The amount of damage at that time was $11 million. $11 million doesn't sound like a lot until you realize it's in 1900, right? It took 2 long years to recover the wreckage from the ice-cold St. Lawrence River. Investigations into the cause of this collapse revealed that the bridge had collapsed due to the poor load calculations and improper design done by the Phoenix Bridge Company. One of the reasons for the failure was for inadequate supervision during construction. However, the dream was not dead for Quebec, and the Canadian government wanted to rebuild the Quebec Bridge with a more sturdy and accurate design. Work started as planned, and after much work, they reached the final stage. When the last span was lifted out of the river and attached it to the projected cantilever arm on both sides, the span again broke down on September 11th, 1916. The substantial middle span of the bridge fell and sank into the St. Lawrence River and killed 13 more workers below. The Canadian government eventually completed the task of the bridge in August 1919 with a total cost of $25 million. A total of 88 workers' lives were lost. Through all the pain, agony, expense, and hardship, success finally came. To this day, the bridge is still standing tall with its head held high and boasts a record for the world's longest cantilever bridge.
All right, guys, so I'm out at Orlando International Airport. Behind me is 528. Right now, they're redoing some of the entrances to get into the airport. One of those entrances being this bridge right here. Now, what's similar between this bridge and the bridge that goes over the St. Lawrence River is that this bridge has its own version of a cantilever bridge in which there's a piece, a big prefabricated piece that is hoisted up by two cranes and is set on already existing concrete load-bearing supports, okay? The difference between this bridge and the one over the St. Lawrence is that this one is obviously a lot smaller, so it does not break any world records. Also, this one is probably much better engineered and won't collapse. At least we hope not, but only time will tell.
Hey guys, so I hope you enjoyed that. Again, this was for a project for my strength of materials class, but if you're watching this on my YouTube channel, please leave a like and subscribe. I hope you enjoyed that. I definitely want to make more of these videos. This is a very interesting topic. I hope you think so too. And thank you guys so much for watching.